Hello learners, welcome back to another video. In this lesson, we're going to learn about a small but mighty component of all living things, and that is the cell. A cell is the smallest structural and functional unit of life that can live on its own and makes up all living organisms. Every organism, from single-celled bacterium to human beings, is made up of cells. Some organisms consist of only one cell, while others contain trillions of cells. Despite their small size, cells are highly organized systems that are capable of energy production, molecule synthesis, reproduction, and all other life processes. Talk about something also very important, which is the cell theory. The cell theory is a fundamental concept in biology that explains the structure, function, and origin of cells. It provides a framework for understanding that all living organisms are composed of cells and emphasizes their importance as the basic unit of life. The cell theory exists today as a result of several brilliant scientists from over hundreds of years ago. The journey of the cell theory begins in 1665 with an English scientist named Robert Hooke. He used a compound microscope to observe a thin slice of cork and saw many tiny box-like compartments. These structures reminded him of the small rooms or cella where monks lived, and so he named them cells. However, due to the type of microscope available at the time, Hooke was only able to observe the non-living cell walls of the cork tissue. A few years later, Antoni van Leeuwenhoek, a Dutch scientist, made a remarkable discovery using a more powerful microscope. He observed living moving organisms in a drop of pond water, which he famously called animalcules. And this was the first time living cells had been observed. These early discoveries became the foundation for what would become the cell theory. Now, the fundamental theory was proposed and refined in the 19th century by three German scientists. Matthias Schleiden, a botanist who in 1838 concluded that all plants are composed of cells. Theodor Schwann, a zoologist who extended this observation to animals in 1839. Stating that all animals are also made of cells. And then Rudolf Virchow, a physician who in 1855 added an important third principle. In Latin, it says omnis cellula e cellula. And this means all cells arise from pre-existing cells. These three principles form the basis of the classical cell theory that we know today. And they are, number one, all living organisms are composed of one or more cells. Number two, the cell is the basic unit of structure and function in living things. And number three, all cells are produced from other cells. Let's go to cell classification. All cells can be broadly classified into two fundamental types. We have prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells. Prokaryotic cells have a simpler structure and are characteristic of single-cell organisms like bacteria and archaea. Their main distinguishing feature is the absence of a true nucleus. Their genetic material, which can be DNA or RNA, is located in a region of the cytoplasm called the nucleoid. Prokaryotes also lack other membrane-bound organelles and are typically very small, ranging from 0.1 to 0.5 micrometers in diameter. Eukaryotic cells, on the other hand, are the structural units of more complex organisms such as plants, animals, fungi, and protozoan. Unlike prokaryotic cells, eukaryotic cells have a true nucleus, which encloses its DNA. These cells are highly organized and have numerous membrane-bound compartments called organelles. These organelles perform specific functions. Eukaryotic cells are much larger than prokaryotic cells, and their size range from 10 to 100 micrometers in diameter. Next, we'll look at the structure of the eukaryotic cell. The structure of the eukaryotic cell includes both the internal environment and the external environment. In the external environment, we have structures like the cell membrane and the cell wall. To maintain its internal environment, every cell is enclosed by a boundary, which is called the cell membrane or the plasma membrane. And this is the outer lining of all cells. It is a flexible barrier that acts as a gatekeeper and controls substances that can enter or leave the cell. It is also a fluid structure that is composed of phospholipid bilayers with embedded proteins that act as channels and transporters. The cell membrane also helps in communication between cells. Plant cells and some other organisms have an additional rigid outer layer called the cell wall, and it is located outside the cell membrane. The cell wall provides structural support and protection and prevents the cell from bursting from excessive water intake. In the internal cell environment, we can find structures like the cytoplasm and the cytoskeleton. The cytoplasm is all the material within the cell, excluding the nucleus. It is comprised of the systole, which is a jelly-like fluid made mostly of water, and organelles that are suspended within it. The cytoplasm is the site of most of the cell's chemical reaction. The cytoskeleton provides shape and organization in the cell. It is a dynamic network of long protein fibers. The cytoskeleton has several important functions. It determines the shape of the cells. It is involved in cell division. It allows for cell movement and provides a track-like system for moving organelles within the cell. I've talked a lot about organelles, so let's see what organelles are. Organelles are tiny compartments in the cell that perform various functions. Each organelle performs a unique role. Let's look at the major cell organelles and their functions. The nucleus. The nucleus is the most noticeable feature. This organelle is often called the cell's headquarters or command center, and it directs the cell's growth, maturation, division, and death. The nucleus is enclosed by a double membrane called the nuclear envelope, which separates its contents from the rest of the cell and has pores to regulate the passage of molecules. Inside the nucleus, we can find dense structures called the nucleolus, which is the site of ribosome synthesis. The nucleus also houses the cell's hereditary material. The nucleus also houses the cell's hereditary material, which is DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid. Next, we have the ribosome and the endoplasmic reticulum. Ribosomes are the protein synthesizers of the cell. They read the genetic instructions from messenger RNA and assemble amino acids into proteins. Ribosomes can be found free in the cytoplasm or attached to the endoplasmic reticulum. The endoplasmic reticulum is a vast network of membranous sacs and tubules that extends throughout the cytoplasm. It plays a primary role in processing molecules, particularly synthesizing proteins, lipids, and steroids. There are two distinct regions of the endoplasmic reticulum, the rough endoplasmic reticulum, and its surface is dotted with ribosomes, making it a primary site for synthesizing and modifying proteins that are used for secretion or for delivery to other organelles. The other region is the smooth endoplasmic reticulum, and this region lacks ribosome and is involved in synthesizing lipids and cholesterol, and also in detoxifying harmful substances and storing calcium ions in muscle cells. Next, we move to the Golgi apparatus and the lysosomes. Once molecules are produced in the endoplasmic reticulum, many are sent to the Golgi apparatus or the Golgi complex for further processing. The Golgi apparatus is like the post office of the cell. Here, proteins and lipids are modified, sorted, and packaged into vesicles for transport to other destinations, either inside or outside the cell. Lysosomes are the cell's recycling center. They contain powerful digestive enzymes that break down foreign bacteria, unwanted materials, and worn-out cell compartments. Lysosomes can digest the cell's own compartments and are sometimes called suicide bags. Next, we have mitochondria and chloroplasts. All cellular activities require energy. The primary energy converters in the eukaryotic cells are the mitochondria, and in plants, the chloroplasts. Mitochondria are famously known as the powerhouse of the cell, and they are responsible for cellular respiration, a process that converts the energy from food into adenosine triphosphate, or ATP. And this is energy that the cell can use. Mitochondria are complex organelles that have their own DNA and can make copies of themselves. Chloroplasts are found in plant cells and are the site of photosynthesis. They capture energy from sunlight and use it to convert carbon dioxide and water into sugars, manufacturing food for plants. They contain chlorophyll, and that is the pigment which gives plants their green color. Let's look at the chemical composition of these cells. The cell is made up of 70% water, 18% protein, 5% lipids, and then 7% carbohydrates, DNA, RNA, and ions. So, we have learned about the individual components of the cell. Let's take a look at how they work together to perform the essential functions of life. The essential functions of life include structure and support, energy production, transport, growth, and reproduction. Structure and support. Cells are the structural units of all organisms and provide structure and support for all organisms. The cell, through processes like respiration and photosynthesis, produces energy needed for all life activities. Transport. Cells maintain a stable internal environment by actively transporting nutrients in and waste products out across the cell membrane. Growth. Organisms can grow through an increase in the number of cells, which happens as a result of cell division, mainly through mitosis. And finally, reproduction. Cells enable reproduction through the processes of mitosis and meiosis, and they pass genetic information to the next generation. So these are some of the reasons why the cell is truly the fundamental unit of life. It is a self-contained, self-replicating marvel of biology. Let's look at some fun facts about cells. There are more bacteria than human cells in the human body. Scientists estimate that the human body contains around 37.2 trillion cells. Out of this, about 95% of the cells in the body are bacteria, meaning there are more bacterial cells in the human body than human cells. But don't worry, most of them are good bacteria. Another fun fact is varying lifespans. Different cells in the human body have different lifespans. Some cells in the digestive tract can only live for a few days, while brain cells can live for an entire lifetime. Some cells, like red blood cells, can live for about 120 days, which is approximately 4 months. Cells are small but mighty. Most cells are between 1 and 100 micrometers in diameter and are invisible to the naked eye. To give you some perspective, it would take about 10,000 human cells to cover the head of a pin. And the last fun fact for this video is that not all cells are microscopic. While most cells are tiny, some are large enough to be seen without a microscope. The largest single-celled organism is an algae called Caulerpa, which can grow up to 10 feet long. That's it for this video. Congratulations. You have successfully learned about the key concepts of the cell. You can now move on to the next lesson.